Hey everybody, welcome to the first video in a series I'm going to start doing for Ninja Gaiden Black. This is going to focus on the individual weapons in the game. There is something that I've been meaning to do for a while, and it's get some, you know, just a lot more tutorial stuff out there for this game. There still seems to be quite a few people playing it and getting into it, which is awesome. But in terms of actual, you know, really kind of in-depth, you know, tutorial type videos out there, there really isn't a whole lot of stuff available. And the one thing about this game is, when you're new to it, I don't really feel that by watching really people that are really good at it, I don't really feel that you can learn a lot just by watching them. Because a lot of the techniques they're doing, you really need to know what they're doing. So that's kind of what I want to do with this. So we're going to start out this video, or this series rather, by breaking down the Dragon Sword. So this is by far the best weapon in the game. And by that, I don't mean it's more powerful than the low health UF or anything like that. We're not even going to start talking about that kind of stuff yet. We're going to keep it real simple. The reason the Dragon Sword is the best weapon in the game is because there is not a single enemy or boss or situation or combination of enemies. There is nothing in the game that this weapon cannot handle. And not only that, it's also the best choice for a lot of enemies. So that's what makes it the best when I say that it is the best weapon in the game. So I have the True Dragon Sword here, and we're going to start out with just going through the moves list and identifying, in my opinion, what are the best moves? What are the moves that you want to be using? Because like a lot of weapons or in any other game that have a load of strings and all these combos, most of them you're not really going to use. So we're going to go through this move list, and I'm just going to quickly highlight what are the best moves. Going from the top. So the first move, right, the first string, is this right here. XXX. This is not particularly great. The first two hits, however, are really good. I mean, you want to bear that in mind, because while they're not listed as a string, every single input you see in the command list of any weapon, you really want to start thinking of them in terms of strings, like you would think of in a fighting game. It's really, really simple if you think of it that way. So, for example, XXX is, you can just press it three times. The one thing about this game, and I'll go through this in other weapons, is all the moves on all the weapons are extremely staggerable. They're delayable. So, for example, in a fighting game, you might have a five-hit string that is really delayable. You might be able to delay all the hits, or the third and fourth hit. Whereas in this game, you can delay virtually everything. So as you can see, this is about the fact, this is as fast as you can do it. This is me just kind of mashing X. Whereas if you really want to take your time, you can go X, X, X. You can really take your time to delay these hits. So, with that in mind, let's go through the rest of the moves. So we have XXX and XXXY. Now, this is only available when you get the True Dragon Sword, or the Plasma Saber Mark II, which is level 4. This string by itself is not particularly, you know, anything amazing. It's not fantastic. However, it does have one very specific use, and that is against the boss Ishtaros. So we will get into that in another video, or I might put something in here. We'll see how these videos evolve over time. But that's about the only reason you're going to want to use that string. Otherwise, it's not really that great. There is a substantial gap between the third and fourth hit, as you can see. You are vulnerable all the time during these strings. So, you know, you can kind of see there's a really good gap there where you can get clipped, and you don't want that. The next string is XXY. This is one of the best moves in the game, by far. This is kind of what makes the Dragon Sword such a good weapon. At level 1, this is, if you were to keep every level, you know, every weapon rather, at the basic level, this is by far the best string in the game. It's super fast, it deals very, very high damage, you recover from it very quickly, it's shuriken cancelable, so it's just really, really good. It's a really good string. A very common technique on the beginning chapters to deal very, very high damage to bosses is to do XXY, Shuriken, and then either go into another combo, or you can do XXY, cancel it into Nimpo, and then carry on. You can abuse the iframes. It's a very, very good move. Next on the list is XXYY and XXYYY. Now, this is an okay string. That's this one right here. XXYY is okay. It's one of my personal favorite strings in the game. I think it looks really cool. But in terms of utility, it's really not that good. It's exactly the same with this. Like, that last hit is super cool, but you're never really going to want to use this move in, you know, group combat. One-on-one, yeah, use it all you want. It's great. Or against big enemies, you know, like like ogres or something like that. Yeah, you can use it all day against those, but in group combat, that move's going to get you killed. The next two on the list are the directional moves, and it's XX forward XX and XX forward XY. These two strings are actually pretty good. You probably won't use these once you get the sword, once you level this up to level 2, but in the early chapters, these actually are quite good strings. This one right here, this is forward X, this is the X variant. That last kick sends enemies really far away from you, and when you knock an enemy into a wall, which we'll get into in a later video, but when you knock an enemy into a wall, you deal substantial damage to them by knocking them into a wall. It deals very, very high damage, and this move at the end, that kick, that spin kick, that knocks enemies into walls. It's very, very good. So the next one is XXX forward XY, which is this one. This ends in like 3 rapid high kicks. Whoops, it would if I could do the string. I haven't played this game in a few years, so I am a little rusty. Bar the speedrun, which is kind of funny. But anyway, so yeah, this one ends in the 3 high kicks. This is really good for stunlocking certain enemies. You can stunlock horses with this pretty easily. But again, other than that, it's not that good. It has a very, very long recovery window, as you can see here. If I do this and then just hold forward, like, look how long it takes me to run after that string's ended. Like, Ryu has to, you know, completely recover from that string. So yeah, it's really not that good. It's not cancelable. You can't shuriken cancel it. So yeah, there's not really much reason to use that string once you get the sword to level 2. One thing real quick is the XX forward X. That is by itself not a string. It's not listed as its own string. However, it's actually a very useful string. That stab in that final hit has a lot of stun on it. It's a lot of hit advantage. You can stun enemies with that for a very long time. So that's just something to bear in mind. Going down the next list, the Blade of Niriti, Blade of Niriti. I gave up years ago trying to pronounce that, so I'm not gonna start now. And the Azuna Drop. These are kind of the absolute staples of the Dragon Sword. I could do with enemies to show this in form, but really these are kind of your main moves with this weapon. And it's XY. This is the launcher part. So, you can do this at level 1, but you need the sword at least level 2 before you can perform the Azuna Drop. The Azuna Drop is a scroll, so you need to have that purchased as well. However, this gives you access to one of the best strings this sword has, and that's its X, Y, and its extensions. So, the problem with Blade of Niriti is that it's incredibly bad on hit. Like, you the amount of recovery on this move is substantial. You can't move after it. However, it does give you access to do things like this. This is XYXY. This is an extremely fast string. The Helm Splitter is actually not that bad on hit. You're quite safe after that. The good thing about it is you are able to block instantly as soon as you hit the ground after doing a Helm Splitter. Helm Splitter is just in air Y neutral. What I mean by neutral is when you don't have a direction in the air. Because if you're jumping in a direction, he'll do like the downward slash. If you're jumping just neutral, he'll just do the Helm Splitter move. So that move right there recovers instantly. So as soon as you hit the ground, you are blocking. So XYXY is really good. It's really fast. It deals a lot of damage. And you are blocking as soon as that move ends. You are blocking. Whereas if you do the Blade of Niriti, you are not. You are very vulnerable after that final hit. It's the same with the Azuna Drop. The plus side, obviously, to the Azuna Drop is the huge splash damage that it has. So that's going to knock enemies away from you. So you don't really need to worry about it too much. So that kind of gets into that, really. You can obviously customize these strings with shurikens in air. You know, any projectile that you can use regular shurikens. You can use the windmill shuriken if you want to get guys away from you. You can do X, Y, and then throw the windmill shuriken. And then that will knock them really, really far. If you want to kind of tie up enemies for a while, you can use the incendiary. You can do XY incendiary. The incendiaries have a long stun and then they will explode. So if you have, say, a cat fiend or a commando fiend that you want to kind of take out of the picture for a few seconds, you can do that on them. And I think that's it. Yeah, that's it for projectiles in air. Let's get back to it. So the next set of moves are going to be its wild running moves and its running properties. There's actually quite a few of these, and they're very, very useful. So the first one is going to be windmill slash, which is getting ahead of myself here. The directional moves, not running moves. The windmill slash is one of the reasons why this weapon is so good. This move right here, it's listed in the moves list as direction X. What that basically means is forward to where you want it to go. So I'm looking at the camera right now as Ryu. If I press the analog stick, in the direction that I want him to do this in, and then X, he'll do it. So if I want him to go to the right, I just have to press right and then X, left X, up X, like diagonal up, diagonal down, right, left, right, down. He'll always do it in the direction you tell him to do it. The main reason this move is so good is that it has the same invulnerability properties as the regular roll. So when you get really comfortable with this weapon, you don't even have to worry about rolling before attacking an enemy. You can just do this right through their attack. If it's a string, you're going to have to bear in mind what string it is, like a berserker's two-hit string. If you try and do this through a berserker hit string, you're going to roll through the first hit, but then he's going to hit you through the second one. So you don't want to do that. But what makes it so good is that you can do it out of rolls. So you can cancel a roll into this move. So this basically gives you a double roll. So it's a very, very powerful move in terms of defense. If you have smoke bombs available to you, you can do a triple roll. So you can do roll, this, and then a smoke bomb. Or you could do smoke bomb, windmill slash, roll. This gives you an incredible amount of invulnerability frames and very, very few chances for the enemies to hit you. And by dropping the smoke bomb through this, you also gain yourself a little bit of time to maneuver around your enemy. So let's say, for example, you're fighting a cat fiend who loved to jump all over the shop. You can roll, smoke bomb, windmill slash right through their attack, and follow up. So that's kind of a more convoluted way, but that's one of the main reasons this weapon is so good, is that windmill slash. You can also cancel windmill slash into any string you want. So if you want to do it into the regular strings, the only thing you have to remember is that when you're doing this, he will auto-default into while running status. So if you do forward XX and keep your thumb pressed on the analog stick, he'll do those running kicks. So as you can see, while running, you press Y, he'll do those kicks. So forward XX, YY with your thumb still on the analog stick leaves you in a running state, which is basically means, you know, you're going to run, so you'll get either the two-hit slash move or you'll get the kicks move. So this is forward XX with that on. If you want to go into a string, you have to let the stick go back to neutral. So let's say you want to do windmill slash into Izuna drop. If you keep your thumb on, you'll just go right into the forward Y because you're already holding forward like that. If you want to do this into a regular string, let's say, for example, we want to do it into this string right here where the red bar is, Blade of the Twin Dragons. This is also one of the main reasons this weapon is so good, is because this string is extremely powerful and you can do this string out of a windmill slash. Really quick, on the command list, when you see the little arrow on top of the button, the face button, that just means you have to hold down the button. So, for example, if you look at the Azure Dragon and the Scarlet Dragon, that's just got one direction. So, which order were they in? Azure Dragon is first. So, Azure Dragon is just forward Y, which is this. The basic launcher of the Dragon Sword, like, you know, the kind of king of launchers in this game. The other one, which was called something else, Scarlet Dragon, is hold it down and press forward, which is that. That right there. That's that move. That's that. That's holding the button down. That's holding the button down. That's tapping the button. So, on this string right here, the triple Y one, forward, hold down Y, and then press Y twice. So that is this string right here. This is an extremely powerful string. It deals huge damage, and it's got a lot of stun on it. The only downside to it is, obviously, it's very slow. As you can see, that forward Y takes a while to come out. However, with Windmill Slash, you can just go right into it out of Windmill Slash. You get the invulnerability of a roll, and you can go right into that string. That has a couple of very specific uses. It's really, really good against Doku, and it's really, really good against Berserkers, and it's really good against Laser Crab Fiends. It's just extremely powerful. It's so good. So that covers that. The UTs, I'm going to get into in a minute, because they're kind of a separate thing. So here we are. Here's while running. I've covered this a little bit in what I just said, but while running is basically when you're moving like this, or when you're coming out of Windmill Slash, you will have running status. So this move right here is XX. Big Alcy calls this the Slish Slash move, which I think is very fitting, as it's like, yeah, 1-2, Slish Slash. It's really good. This move is actually extremely powerful, and there's a very good reason for this. Some moves in this game have an insane amount of active frames, and that causes them to connect more than once throughout that animation. This is one of them. This is actually only a two-hit move, as you can kind of see here. It's only two hits. However, if you can actually get the fourth, if you can get something directly in front of you and then hit them with this, you can hit them like up to five times with these two moves, and it deals a lot of damage. So that's something to bear in mind. It's really good against Dynamo. It's really good against Ishtaros. It's good against Hydra Cubus. Just off the top of my head. While running, I would explain these. That's these kicks. These are kind of useless. You don't like these are cool for style. Doing that and kicking the guy into a wall looks pretty sweet. But they're not very practical. You don't really want to use those. So next on the list is the rotate, like the 360Y. Now, while that and that diagram kind of shows you a full rotation, you actually don't need to do anywhere near a full rotation. As long as you do at least half a circle, you will get these moves to come out. So the regular version of this is that. That's just holding down Y. That's just tapping Y, sorry, after a rotate of the stick. That's really not that useful outside of Awakened Alma. It's very, very good for knocking down Awakened Alma after Haste Straight Slash, which is that move right there. But other than that, you don't really want to use this move. It's not really that useful. The other variant of this is when you hold down Y, which is the Gleaming Blade, which is by far the single best move in the game. Like, free. Absolutely. This move is absolutely broken. It's in just off the top of my head, let's go off of the list. It's incredibly powerful. It's one of the most powerful moves in the game. It's a UT, so you can have, you know, full invulnerability frames. You have an insane amount of invulnerability after a UT if this has been connected. You can just loop this over and over and over again if you have staggered essence. It's absolutely ridiculous. Even on regular hit, which is non-UT, you have full armor when this move is active. And what I mean by armor is you cannot be hit out of this move. So once you let it rip, that's it. The move's coming out no matter what. You can take a lot of damage depending on what hits you. But for the most part, you'll probably only take one or two hits. Worst case scenario. And anything this move hits is dead, pretty much. You only get this move at level 3. Which is, you know, it makes sense. As I said, it's such a powerful move. But at level 4, with the True Dragon Sword, it's insane how much damage this move deals. Like, regular ET or UT, it's insane. The damage output is ridiculous. So that's how you do that move. That move can also be done in on-landing status, by the way. So, because it's a UT, you can do on-landing Gleaming Blades. As I said, just make sure you do, like, at least half a rotate of the stick, and you'll get this to come out on landing. So, against the really big enemies, like Ogres, that gives you access to do stuff like XY, XXX, and then you land with on-landing Gleaming Blade. Does a ton of damage. Absolute ton. So, I think that's about it. Apart from counterattacks, yep, we've covered all those. These are all universal moves. Okay, so counterattacks with the Dragon Sword, really straightforward. The first counterattack is just the basic, you know, you press X once. I'll put in some actual footage over this part, because otherwise it's not really going to make a lot of sense. The first hit of the counterattack is by far the best, because it's really, really fast, really, really quick to recover, and it knocks enemies away from you, which is what you want. The second hit is very powerful, but it's very slow and it's a lot of recovery in it, so you don't really want to use that too much. Counterattack Y is really good if all the enemies around you are the only ones you need to worry about and you want to knock them all up in the air and stun them. That's really good, but other than that, it's just so unsafe on, like, you know, when people are around you, they can easily mess you up bad for doing that. Okay, so that goes over the moves list and the top moves. So to quickly recap, the top moves for the Dragon Sword, in no particular order, but the best moves, XXY, easily. XY and everything related to it. So XYX, Y, you know, XYY, Izuna Drop, etc., etc., you know, best move. Gleaming Blade, ridiculous. Best move in the game, easily. This string, hold down Y, and the Windmill Slash. And again, all its variants. Windmill Slash into this, Windmill Slash into forward Y, Windmill Slash into Smoke Bomb, everything we talked about. The last thing to cover is its UT. Again, I'll put some more different footage over this, and I'm just going to be talking over it, so apologies if it's not quite perfect. You get access to two UTs with this weapon. You get the regular UT from level 1 to level 3, which just does more damage, and then you get a new UT with the True Dragon Sword. The UT with the True Dragon Sword is really, really good, but it's very specific. You only really want to use that on enemies where all the flying swallows will hit, because it's a massive launcher, and then he just does, I think it's like 9 or 10 flying swallows through the enemy, deals a shitload of damage, and then he slashes down. It's really, really good. Huge amount of invulnerability frames. The hitbox on the flying swallows is enormous, so it's going to tag stuff that's trying to get you, and if enemies jump into it, which looks awesome, they get caught up in it and they virtually die, so that's really, really cool. The Gleaming Blade doesn't gain anything from the True Dragon Sword upgrade. It just does a lot more damage. So that's nice to have. The regular UT is really good to take out single enemies or manipulate it to incapacitate or weaken more than one. So that's really good to have. And the ET is pretty straightforward. It's probably the single best ET in the game because it can double connect on enemies. Again, this will be some different footage here. So what I mean by that is when you are a specific distance away from enemies, the ET on the Dragon Sword has an amazing amount of active frames, and its hitbox is huge. And because of that, it can double connect. You can see that used on, like, you know, Evil Ryu in the Archive Challenge. You can see it used on Awakened Alma, Nikkei, regular Alma. Even man-sized enemies, you know, like, if you really want to take out man-sized enemies, really, and by man-sized enemies, I mean, like, imps, cat fiends, ninjas, anything that can be a Zuna drop, basically. Forward YM, on landing ET, they're dead. Nothing can survive that. The only thing that can survive that are bosses. You know, a double-connecting ET will kill any enemy it touches that isn't a boss. So, yeah, it's incredibly powerful and really, really worth using. The timing can be a bit tricky with it, but, you know, with enough practice, you'll get it. Okay, so that covers the moves and all that other stuff. That took way longer than I thought, but as I said, there's a lot to this game. There is a lot to cover. So, moving on, we're going to go on to part two, which is utility and uses. Now, this is probably going to be cut together with some different footage, so just bear with me. So what I mean by that is what you want to use this weapon for. So as I said at the start, the Dragon Sword is the best weapon in the game. It can handle anything. However, you don't really want to use it against berserkers. You want to use a heavy weapon against berserkers. Even though the Dragon Sword can deal with the berserkers just fine, the heavy weapons can deal with them a little bit better. So what do you want to use the Dragon Sword for? The main thing is bosses in particular. You want to use it for Alma, Awakened Alma, Nikkei, Ishtaros, and Hydra Cubus if you don't have anything else available. They're kind of the main bosses that you want to use the Dragon Sword on. The other things are, as I said before, any man-sized enemy that can be Izuna dropped is pretty free to the Dragon Sword because the Izuna drop's so powerful. Zombies is okay if you don't have the flails for whatever reason, but like the Dragon Sword can, you know, handle zombies just fine. And again, if you don't have the Dragon Sword, if you don't have the nunchucks, it's actually really, really good for Ghostfish because of this move right here. So cut back to the rainy outside bit. And I actually forgot to cover this move in the moves section, so that's kind of a blow up. But this move only really has one use anyway, and that is for Ghostfish. It's called the Air Destruction Slash, and it's your directional in-air X move. And by directional, as I said, I mean when you're jumping in a direction. So jump forward, you'll get this. If you're jumping neutral, you just get in-air X, which is a horizontal slash. You want to use this move right here when you are jumping in a direction. This has an enormous hitbox, and it downs enemies that it hits. So even if, you know, an enemy can be stood up, but if you clip them with this, you knock them down. It downs enemies really, really well. And the really good thing about this is that you have a lot of just straight up invulnerability on this move when you land. Enemies can't get you. I don't know what causes this, but you know, it makes it really good for getting through ghostfish if you don't want to fight them. Because while the flails and the chucks are really good for killing ghostfish, if you just can't be bothered to fight them, just jump through them and do this move right here. They won't be able to touch you. So that's another top move. We'll edit that. Actually, I won't edit that. If you've watched this far, then you're clearly interested. So we'll leave it in. Okay, so the next one is going to be just general do's and don'ts. This is kind of going into utility and moveset. The big don't ever use this move right here. This move is garbage. It's terrible. It's kind of weird that the best weapon in the game also has the worst move in the game by far. But this is just the tap Y move. Like, I can't remember what this move is called. I think it's called something like Blade of the Undefeated. There we go. Blade of the Undefeatable is just tap Y. This move is terrible. Huge startup, as you can see. Huge recovery. Like, I'm going to hold forward. Look how long it takes me to start moving. Huge startup, huge recovery. Does no damage. Like, has no priority over attacks. It's just really, really, really bad. So that's the big don't. The next one. There's not many, to be honest. The next one is just don't be reckless with the flying swallows. The flying swallow is a really, really good move, but you don't really want to use it, like, you know, on big enemies or enemies with, you know, really, really good reach on their moves, because there's so much recovery to this move. As you can see here, look, I'm going to hold forward, and when he lands, like, just look how long it takes me to start moving. Like, there's so much recovery in that move. So don't be reckless with that. General do's, though, things to do. Abuse the living hell out of this move right here. Whether this is ET'd or not, this is Hay Straight Slash, which is just the non-ET'd version. It's super good. Again, it has armor the same way that the Gleaming Blade has, so you can't be knocked out of the animation once it starts, so it will knock down enemies. It has a ginormous hitbox. Its hitbox is the size of the moon. So you can easily catch enemies trying to jump at you with this move. So really, really abuse this. It's really good. It goes double for the ET variant, where you have one essence. You know, abuse the hell out of it. It's so good. It's really, really powerful. Abuse the first hit of counterattack X. It's amazing. It knocks enemies away from you, knocks them airborne. It sets them up perfectly for a follow-up forward Y Azuna drop. So, you know, just abuse that to no end. And the last thing, really, to abuse on this is fire wheels with it. If you want to add extra damage, this is kind of a Nimpo thing, but if you want to add extra damage to your strings or your Gleaming Blade, pop fire wheels. It's really good. Fire wheels seem to connect. I tried to figure out like how fire wheels scale, and I can't really figure it out to a T, but fire wheels just seem to connect based on what you're doing. So if you're just stood next to something, they won't actually connect as often as it looks. But if you do a move, they seem to connect more. So, you know, if you want to add damage to your Gleaming Blade, really abuse fire wheels. It's really, really good. So, the last thing I want to get into is just some, you know, special bits of information, little tidbits, little stuff that people might not know. So, the first one for that is this move right here, the in-air, just in-air Y neutral. This has a really, really good amount of invulnerability frames on the way down. So, for example, if you get in a sticky situation, let's say you're fighting Incendiary Shuriken Ninjas and you get stuck with Incendiary, and there's no wall for you to go on. You can't roll because you're surrounded by enemies. Just jump and do that. Worst case scenario, you'll take the chip damage of the Incendiary, you'll ground something right in front of you so you can Fiend Seal them. Good to go. Real, real good. Speaking of the Fiend Sealer, that's the another next bit of information to do. I'm going to put in some footage with this, so it hopefully lines up. When you are going to do a Fiend Sealer with this move, this is the main reason this move is such a piece of crap, is because this move takes priority over your Fiend Sealer all the time, and it's really annoying. The way to counter this is to roll before you go for your Fiend Sealer. Roll and hold down Y. That will get your Fiend Sealer to come out instead of this. If you just tap Y to go for a Fiend Sealer, Fiend Sealer, by the way, is the, you know, the grounded stab move when enemies are on the floor. If you just tap Y, 99 times out of 100, you'll get this move right here, which you do not want, because this move sucks. So that's another little tip. Make sure to roll before you do your Fiend Sealer, and really hold down the Y button. The other special bit of info for this weapon is the movement it gives you. It's kind of the last thing, really. You'll have seen this in probably calm runs and speed runs. In-air destruction slash shuriken cancel Y is fantastic for covering, you know, lots of ground. In-air shurikens Y off a flying bird flip gives you loads of airtime to evade like Marbus projectiles, Nikkei projectiles, etc., etc. Alma projectiles is another one. And that pretty much covers it for the Dragon Sword and the True Dragon Sword. I am going to go over the Kitetsu separately. I did think about doing these you know, together, but the Kitetsu actually has some really interesting properties that the Dragon Sword doesn't have, so I'm actually going to do a separate video for that. So, yeah, that's it for this one, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. This was way longer than I thought, but yeah, there's a lot. There's a lot to talk about in the nitty-gritty of this game. So let me know what you guys think. I hope this helped. You know, if you are new to the game and picking it up, I hope this helped. I hope you picked up some tips and tricks. And I'll see you in the next video, guys. Peace.